Change Management Act, recent developments. Mondays are always special because they are the first day of a new week when we are fresh once again to move on to the accomplishments of our goals and our objectives. Updated knowledge and skills are the order of the day. And today, for the special order of the day, we are privileged to have amongst us a thorough professional, committed and competent company secretary, Mr. Devendra V. Deshpande. He is a council member of ICSI, the Institute of Company Secretaries of India, a statutory body constituted under the Act of Parliament. He is a practicing company secretary since 2004 and having areas of practice in the fields of corporate laws, foreign exchange laws, audits, company law, allied law, secretarial audits of listed and unlisted entities. He is also the chairman of various committees under the ICSI for the year 2020. He is a vice chairman of Auditing Standard Board and lead central council member of WIRC, and also the nominee director of Insolvency Professional Agency, the ICICI IIP. He has delivered sessions and lectures at various seminars and conferences of various chapters and regions of Institute of Company Secretaries of India, Institute of Chartered Accountants of India, and Cost Accountants. He has represented ICSI at the International Conference of Company Secretaries held in Kenya and delivered a keynote address. He is the first company secretary to receive a Youth Icon Award 2019 in the field of corporate affairs from Purnabad Yuva Forum. Sir, welcome you to LPU, one of the top 100 institutions of India as per the latest NIR ranking, having the most of the state-of-the-art infrastructure and processes. And we take pride in our students who are always willing to go an extra mile for skill updations. So ladies and gentlemen, young youth icons, welcoming the youth icon, put your hand together for his inputs on the recent developments in the FEMA, the company secretary, Mr. Devendra V. Deshpande.
Thank you, Sarbjit Singh. Good afternoon, friends. I am really happy to be here, and thanks to Dr. Kotoch for inviting me to this lovely professional university. It is a really a lovely feeling for me, and as the name of your university suggests, it's really a wonderful feeling for me to talk to the young guns and the next generation MBA students. And it's really a privilege for me as a company secretary to talk to you about Foreign Exchange Management Act. I must tell you that as a company secretary, we are a compliance people, and we talk about compliances. But as management students, I know, and now even these days, even the role of company secretary is changing drastically, and wherein the concept of giving solutions and providing solutions, and actually we take every problem as a project. So management students also, they take every problem as a project and try to give solutions. And whenever we are giving any kind of solutions, which we should be knowing the basic background about certain things. And that is why I think your university has planned for this particular session on Foreign Exchange Management Act. You all must be aware that Foreign Exchange Management Act is something to do with foreign currency, foreign investment, loans from abroad, Reserve Bank of India, and all these things. So I think we will be discussing few of the important issues of Foreign Exchange Management Act. I'm sharing my presentation here. So am I, my presentation is visible now?
Yes, sir. But it's
can somebody just confirm?
We can put it in the slide mode. It is visible. Please put it on slide mode.
Yeah. Is it fine now?
I think it's come. Yes, sir. Fine.
Yeah.
Good to go, sir.
Yeah. Thank you very much. Thanks a lot. It is very difficult and different to speak in a webinar kind of a session, because usually what happens whenever we take actual sessions, there is a response from the students or a response from the participants. But here I'm sitting at my home and looking at the screen, I'm not really able to understand whether whatever I'm speaking and whatever I'm delivering, it is reaching the people to whom it is directed. But it is new normal. We all have gone through this new normal thing wherein we have to deliver the sessions online without the real response. Even the IPL these days is going on. It has started 2 days back. And even in IPL, we can see that there are no spectators, but some music has been played just to have the feel of the participants. So similarly, I'm just getting a feel of the participants, whether they are able to receive my presentation and all. So today, folks, we will be discussing a few of the important points. These are the contents. Let me tell you that I don't have many slides. It's around 10-15 slides wherein we will be discussing few of the important aspects of Foreign Exchange Management Act, which is one of the most important act if you consider anything about a transaction between an Indian person and a person who is resident abroad. There are 2-3 concepts which we must understand. One is Indian citizen. Indian citizen also includes the Indian company, three firms and everything. There is one concept called as NRI, that is non-resident Indian, who is actually a resident outside India but staying in India for more than 182 days in last financial year, the last calendar year, and on that basis his residential status is determined. So there are 2-3 different kinds of persons, like resident, non-resident and foreign national. So these three concepts are there. Whenever you are dealing with such people, NRIs or person resident outside India, or there is a transaction between one resident and one non-resident, there is a requirement of looking into the intricacies of Foreign Exchange Management Act. Foreign Exchange Management Act is regulated by Reserve Bank of India. So first we will see what Reserve Bank of India is, what is its role and what is its importance. Then we will look at in the role of Reserve Bank of India, we'll think about and we will discuss about minting of currency. You all must have gone through the demonetization phase and you might have understood that how much money is getting circulated in India is controlled by Reserve Bank of India. We will discuss that. Then we will discuss there was an act called as Foreign Exchange Regulation Act, which was converted into Foreign Exchange Management Act in 2000, and as the name suggests, Foreign Exchange Regulation Act to Foreign Exchange Management Act. So there is a difference between regulation and management. So those differences we will discuss, and what are the things which are coming out of Foreign Exchange Management Act we will discuss. Then current and capital account transactions. These are two types of transactions which takes place between a person residing in India and person residing abroad, or vice versa. So we will discuss that, receiving the foreign exchange, payment in foreign exchange, and how to go about it, that we will discuss. Then foreign direct investment, so FDI. We have been talking about FDI, we have been listening about FDI. Every day in newspaper, there is some news about FDI. You might have gone through the details of Atmanirbhar Bharat, or you might have seen Make in India concept. I'm not favoring any of the political views, but definitely these are the schemes of Indian government to promote foreign direct investments, and we will look into these details also. ECB is something like external commercial borrowing. It is extended arm of foreign direct investment. We will discuss that, and we will discuss few of the offenses under the FEMA regulations, and how people do certain offenses, and how FEMA restricts that. All these things we will definitely discuss. So I hope I am clear about the contents and we are good to go. I'm not able to receive the feedback from you, but definitely we will go ahead. So first of all, Reserve Bank of India. Reserve Bank of India is the apex bank in India, and it is for just general parlance, we must know that Reserve Bank of India is nothing but a bank to bankers. So whatever bankers are doing, they are controlled and regulated by a supreme bank, a apex bank, a central bank, which is called as Reserve Bank of India. It regulates the issue of banknotes. You all must be using the banknotes, like the notes which are circulated in India, 10 rupee, 20 rupee, 100 rupee, 50 rupee, now 500 and 2000 rupees. So those notes are being regulated by Reserve Bank of India. Why they regulate and how they regulate, we will we'll discuss this in the next slide. Keeping of the reserves, because you must understand that there are a lot of transactions which are going between citizens of India and citizens of maybe China or citizens of America or US or UK or whatever country. So there are a lot of transactions, imports and exports. Recently, there has been some lot of issues in respect of exports of onions. You might have seen this in the recent news. So why such decisions are taken to restrict the onions? There are two things. One is to have a control over the pricing of those onions in India, as well as to have a good supply of onions in India. And ultimately, there will be a balance of trade. So there might be exports of 1,000 rupees, imports of 500 rupees. Then there is a difference between difference of 500 rupees. So there has to be some balance. Reserve Bank of India always think that Indian country, India, should be in positive in respect of foreign exchange concern. So we spend 1,000 rupees and we earn 500 rupees is bad. It is negative. So it should be other way around. We should earn 1,000 rupees as foreign exchange and we should spend 500 rupees as foreign exchange. Then our reserve or foreign exchange will be 500 rupees. And that is how Reserve Bank of India controls or regulates. Sometimes it regulates the inflow of the foreign exchange. Sometimes it regulates the outflow of foreign exchange. And all these regulations are forming part of act called as Foreign Exchange Management Act. Then Reserve Bank of India has got different departments like payment and settlement system. You all must be, as MBA students, you all must be knowing about RTGS and NEFT transactions which are happening nowadays, Paytm, Google Pay, UPI services. All these are being controlled and regulated by Reserve Bank of India. So Reserve Bank of India decides that within how much time you should do NEFT, within how much time the bank should clear and the amount should get deposited. So you must be aware that RTGS gets credited to your account in 1 minute, but NEFT takes two hours time. And there are a lot of different regulations which are applicable to RTGS and NEFT. That is the role of Reserve Bank of India. They put certain restrictions on certain transactions and certain limits so that there is no parallel economy which is running in the country. We will discuss what is parallel economy and how it gets created. That also we will discuss in the slides to come. But this is the role of Reserve Bank of India, and that is how they even control the internal payment and settlement system. Foreign Exchange Department is the most important department of Reserve Bank of India, which actually controls this Foreign Exchange Management Act. And Foreign Exchange Department is one of the important department if we consider FEMA as the base of discussions. Next one is Enforcement Director. You might have heard this ED thing in many of the cases. Like you might have heard it in Sushant Singh case or many cases. That Enforcement Directorate. So Enforcement Directorate is one of the important functions of Reserve Bank of India, wherein they actually enforce certain provisions of the law, like Foreign Exchange Management Act, through their mechanism. So they are the directorates who actually enforce the law when somebody is really not following the law, which is law of the land. So for FEMA, there is an Enforcement Directorate, and they also have a lot of authority to investigate and summon and so many things. So these are the functions of Reserve Bank of India. Reserve Bank of India has got maximum authority of penal provisions. Like if you go through the various provisions of various acts and laws, you will understand that, okay, penalties are in the range of starting from 1,000 rupees, ranging to maximum up to 1 crore, 5 crore, 10 crores. But here, Reserve Bank of India has got immense power. They have got authority to charge a penalty considering the how many defaults have been made and how serious are the defaults, they have the authority to actually charge you a penalty which may range up to 3 times of the amount involved. So for example, if I bring some money from abroad and which is not as per the law, and that amount which I brought is 1,000 rupees, then Reserve Bank of India has got authority to charge a penalty on that particular transaction up to 3,000 rupees. So understand, if I do some wrong thing in FEMA, I may be required to pay the thrice of the amount of contravention amount. So this is how Reserve Bank of India and their provisions are so important. And recently, I was reading through this news article wherein RBI has fined the bankers up to the range of 109 crores in 2019, and which was 96 crores in 2018. The violations may be non-following of some reserve, CRR ratios or something like that. So RBI is very strict and their officers are also very strict. There is a perfect policy for handling such cases. There is a proper system of handling the cases, and they have got a maximum authority of charging up to three times of the amount involved. So we must be very, very much aware, and we should pay attention whenever we are giving solution to our clients or our entrepreneurs or the employees, employers, that whenever there is a foreign exchange transaction, we should go through the latest FEMA provisions and Foreign Exchange Management Act should be studied, and then only certain steps should be taken. So this is the basic purpose why this particular session has been kept by your university, because maybe in a year or two, you would be actually going into the corporate world, you would be giving, you would be in the top management, and in top management, there will be a lot of discussions on such transactions. Like, I can give you one very good example. The rate of interest which is being charged by our Indian banks is around 8%. It ranges from 8% to 15%, depending on the what is the security, how much is the margin and everything. But understand, there are countries outside India where people pay loan, people give loan at a rate which is around 2%. So there is a difference of 6%. So everybody would be like ready to take loan from abroad, because I'm saving my 6% on my loan. The interest portion I'm saving, so that is my profit. Every rupee saved is every rupee earned. But it has been restricted. There are regulations, there are restrictions. So whenever you are giving such advice, you must know what are the restrictions. Those things we will discuss in detail when we talk about external commercial borrowing. So this is how one should understand what is the role of Reserve Bank of India and how we should be aware about. Yeah. So next point is minting of currency. So even my daughter, who is around 12 years old, she asked me that why Reserve Bank of India cannot just keep on printing of notes, so that India will have a lot of currency, India will have a lot of money, and then nobody will be poor. So this is a question which comes to her mind and which comes to the mind of many people. So we must understand that minting of currency is not very easy. I have put in two different kind of notes here. One is 1 rupee note and one is 10 rupee note, a part of 10 rupee note. So there is a lot of difference between a 1 rupee note and a 10 rupee note. All the coins which are there are the real currency. And 1 rupee note is the real currency. These are the only currency which has been issued by finance department. So they decide that how much money should flow in the country, and they issue the notes and the coins based on their calculation. Now, if you look at the 10 rupee note or any note beyond 1 rupee, you will see that it is not a note issued by finance department or the government. It is a promissory note. You might be knowing the Negotiable Instrument Act. Yeah. So bill of exchange, promissory note, check. These are the kinds of negotiable instruments which are prevalent in India. So promissory note is the note wherein one person says that, okay, I promise to pay you XYZ rupees on a particular date or on its presentation. So if you look at the 10 rupee note, which might be in your wallet even today, right now, then it is nothing but a promissory note. So promissory note is signed by the governor of Reserve Bank of India, and it says that I promise to pay a sum of rupees 10 to the holder of this note. So there is a difference between the notes which we use and the notes which are issued by finance department. Now, why RBI cannot keep on minting money? I'll give you one example, very good story. So in a village, there are two farmers. Yeah, there are only two farmers. One is producing 1 kilo of rice, and one is providing certain other services. So what is happening? Mr. A is purchasing rice at 10 rupees. He is paying 10 rupees to Mr. B. Mr. B is taking services from Mr. A at 10 rupees. So 10 rupees are getting circulated. So that is the maximum required amount for the transaction between these two. Just 10 rupees, and circulation will be 20 rupees. So GDP would be 20 rupees. So this is fine. This is absolutely fine. If country brings in 100 rupees in this economy of two farmers, what will happen? Person will have 100 rupees in his hand, and the other person will say that, okay, now my rice cost 100 rupees. So what happens, you know, if we keep on minting money, the rate of the products which are there in India will start increasing. And that is why there has to be a balance between how much money should get circulated in the country. So that is the role of RBI, wherein they control the minting of currency. Now, on what grounds they regulate this currency printing is the bullion reserve. Bullion, you all must be knowing, it is the gold reserve, which is the real reserve of Reserve Bank of India. And on the basis of how much gold they have, on that basis, they regulate that how much currency should flow in the country. And you all must be aware that even the government of India has come up with a bullion notes, which various individuals actually invested, and they are nothing but for improving your bullion reserves. Then foreign exchange reserves, the foreign exchange reserves, as I told you, there has to be a balance of payment between the receivable and payable foreign exchange. I'll tell you one important thing. In 1991, when Narasimha Rao ji was Prime Minister of India, at that time, the foreign exchange reserve has dropped to such a level because of the more imports and less exports. So the entire situation was in a very bad shape, that the total foreign exchange amount which was available with India would have lasted only for 3 weeks. And if there was no new thing which was done, or without any initiative or new regulation, there was no possibility of improving the foreign exchange reserve. That is why they came up with a liberalization policy. So whenever we talk about 1991 liberalization policy, the base of that policy was that the total amount of foreign exchange reserve has gone to such a level that India could have sustained only for 3 weeks. After that, India would have been left with zero foreign exchange, and they would not be able to trade with any of the outside world. So that was a situation. They came up with this 1991 policy, and then the foreign direct investment actually started coming to India. Foreign companies started coming to India. Foreign companies started investing in India, and then slowly it was all regulated through FIPB, yeah, and through government regulations, SIA, Secretariat of Department of FIPB, and they all were regulated, and slowly they came up to Foreign Exchange Regulation Act, and after Foreign Exchange Regulation Act, they moved to Foreign Exchange Management Act. So we will discuss that. Now, demonetization impact, you all must be knowing that what is demonetization. Certain currencies of big denomination were stopped from printing, from circulation, from usage. and a new kind of currency was brought in, and new kind of denominations were brought in to avoid and to stop people running the parallel economy. Now, what is parallel economy? We always talk about parallel economy. What happens, you know, if I have to pay 30% on my income tax, yeah, whatever income I generate, I have to pay 30% on it. So if I do it through bank transactions, yeah, if I earn 100 rupees, I have to pay 30 rupees. There is no way out. I have to make the payment. So to save that particular tax of 30%, what I do or what one person does is he takes 70 rupees in bank and 30 rupees in cash. That cash gets generated in my account, in my hand. It is not disclosed at all. I disclose to income tax that my total income is only 70. I pay income tax of 70 rupees as 21 rupees, and I save 9 rupees. While doing that, while saving 9 rupees, I am generating 30 rupees in my pocket. So now what to do with that? I cannot deposit it in bank, because if I deposit in bank, it will be again taxed. So what I do, I purchase certain things from such a person who accepts cash. And that is how the entire cash system works. And that is why the parallel economy starts developing. So if you start doing this, there will be a complete chain of, say, lakhs of people who are only dealing in cash and creating a parallel economy. If there is a parallel economy, your main economy will go down because your income tax will get reduced. There will be less revenue for the government, less development of the country. That is why, to kill this parallel economy, they brought in demonetization. And the next step which government might come up with is a transaction tax. That is a tax on the banking transaction. So you don't pay any income tax. If you pay 1,000 rupees from one bank account to another, the tax of 0.5% will be charged. So all transaction, there will be a charge of tax. It will not be 30%. It will be very less. But all transactions will have tax, and that will be directly collected from the bankers. So you don't need to worry about cash and saving of taxes. So this is how they are coming up with. So all these changes are very, very important. Now let's look at Foreign Exchange Management Act. Earlier it was Foreign Exchange Regulation Act. As the name suggests, everything was regulated earlier. So you have to take a prior approval if you want to bring in capital from the foreign company, if you want to take capital outside the country, if you want to carry foreign currency abroad. So now I will tell you that individually, if you are going abroad for your studies or for masters or for any other purposes, you have to make the payment of your foreign currency through normal banking channels. Normal banking channels is authorized dealers. Those are the bankers. So class one authorized dealers are all big bankers or nationalized banks and certain bankers which have been mentioned as authorized dealers. So you will have to make the payment through them. And these payments are not regulated at all. You will have to give one declaration that, okay, this money has been used for my studies, and that is why I am transferring this fund from India to abroad. So your funds will be transferred, your payment will be made. There will be no prior approval of Reserve Bank of India. Nothing will be there. Everything will be a smoother thing. Earlier, this required a special approval of Reserve Bank of India because you were required to buy foreign currency for making the payment. So now the things have become very easy, and you just need to report for what purpose you are making the payment. If you want to physically carry a foreign currency abroad for your education or for your some other purposes which are allowed under the act, the maximum amount which you can carry is $10,000. You can carry $10,000. If you are carrying more than $5,000, you will have to declare, and you cannot carry any amount which is more than $10,000. So, and you cannot take, or you cannot carry foreign currency to Nepal and Bhutan. You can carry Indian currency, but you cannot carry a foreign currency in dollars to Nepal and Bhutan. That is because their borders are not sealed, and that is why they have restricted the transfer of foreign currency by hand. So That is a very, very important provision which we must understand. For all transactions between a foreign investor in India, so you look at various outlets these days. McDonald's is here, yeah, which was not there maybe 15, 20 years back. Volkswagen India, they are having their own plant in India. Then for Mercedes-Benz, they are having their plant in India. Jaguar is having plant in India through Tata, and so on and so forth. So if you look at all big multinational companies, they are having some or other investments in India. So now government recently in March 2020, after we had a very bad relation or not so good relation with China and other neighboring countries, they have come up with a restriction on investment from the countries which are sharing the borders with India. So any country which shares a border with Indian border will have to take a prior approval of Reserve Bank of India before they invest a single rupee in India. So now if a Chinese company wants to invest in India, they will have to take a prior approval of Reserve Bank of India, and then only they will be able to invest. So this is the recent change which has happened because of the uncertainties between India and China. So this is a very, very important decision taken in March 2020. Interference of Ministry of Home Affairs only in cases wherein there is a foreign contribution is like a donation. So you must be aware that in some of the countries, just like ATG in our country, that if you donate for a charitable purposes, you get a rebate. So in India, the rebate is from 50% to 100% maximum. But in certain countries abroad, the rebate is from 100% to 150%. So if I donate 100 rupees, I get benefit of 150 rupees. So many of the times what happened, people residing in such countries donate the funds to India. Yeah, 100 rupees they will donate. And what they will say, okay, I am getting the benefit of 150 rupees there. You transfer 50 rupees to my account. So I get the benefit of 150 as well as 50. So by making the payment of 150, I am getting benefit of 200. So that is how few of the donations work, or the offenses under donation work, wherein the Ministry of Home Affairs comes into picture, and they regulate it through FCRA. Foreign Contribution Regulation Act. Yeah. So now everything is based on reporting rather than approvals. Whenever you are in doubt in respect of any transaction, just go to the Reserve Bank of India website. It is one of the simplest website I have ever seen. And just check the master circulars and master directions. These are the most important two points which everyone should understand. That master circulars and master directions of Reserve Bank of India downloaded from the website are the final source of law for the purpose of implementation of FEMA. So these two are most important points when it comes to source of law. So Reserve Bank of India on a regular basis issue these circulars and directions for the purpose of giving the directions and regulations to the citizens of India or citizens abroad. Now we will come to thumb rule. The thumb rule of FEMA is very, very simple. What they say, we will allow you everything which is benefiting our foreign exchange reserve. So I will give you a very simple example. If a value of my shares, We are talking about a company, a private limited company, Indian company incorporated in India. Yeah, you might have recently seen Reliance getting the investments from 9 outside Indian like entrepreneurs, like Facebook. They are from US, yeah? And Facebook invested certain money in Reliance. So this is nothing but a FDI, foreign direct investment. So what Indian company should do? As per FEMA, the thumb rule is very clear. If the value of your shares is 10 rupees, you can sell those shares to a foreign company at any rate, which is either 10 rupee or more than 10 rupee. You cannot sell those shares at 9 rupees to a foreigner. If you want to sell in India, if I want to sell my shares to XYZ, I can sell it at any rate. Valuation may be 100 rupees, I can sell it at 20 rupees. Because I need 20 rupees urgently, there is time value of money, everything. On that basis, I can prove, okay, I wanted to sell this at 20 rupees. There are no restrictions. There can be some tax implications, but no restrictions. But when it comes to FEMA, the transaction of sell from resident to non-resident, from resident to non-resident, has to be above fair valuation or at fair valuation. And other way around, if it is sale from foreign national to Indian, it has to be either at fair value or below fair value. So we are trying to save our foreign exchange reserves. So this is the thumb rule which everyone should understand. And on this thumb rule only, the entire FEMA is dependent upon. So this is about Foreign Exchange Management Act. I hope that you are understanding the concepts which I'm just trying to tell you. Next one is current account transactions and capital account transactions. Now, every transaction can be bifurcated into current and capital account. It is very, very easy to bifurcate, even though the regulations have different definitions, different provisions, different restrictions on the transactions. But I am telling you the basic fact or the thumb rule again. Yeah, the thumb rule is, any transaction which is having an impact on the balance sheet is a capital transaction. We are aware that there is balance sheet and profit and loss account. If a transaction is related to balance sheet, so if I am taking loan, if I am issuing securities like debentures, shares, notes, everything, my balance sheet is getting affected. If I am selling my immovable property, balance sheet is getting affected. Yeah. So every transaction which is affecting the balance sheet is capital, and every transaction which is affecting the profit and loss is a current account transaction. So if I am paying my fees for studies abroad, it is not affecting my balance sheet, it is affecting my profit and loss account. So my profit and loss account is getting affected. So I will not even look at the capital account transaction regulations. I will look at current account transactions. And from current account, I will get to know whether what I am permitted and what I am not permitted. Now, again, the thumb rule, when we talk about current account transaction, it is permitted unless prohibited specifically by FEMA. So all current account transactions are permitted unless they are specifically prohibited or regulated by FEMA. Like what I told you, yeah, you can carry currency notes abroad. You are allowed to carry, there is no problem, but they have been specifically regulated up to an amount of $10,000. So this is a regulation. Capital account transaction, it is other way around. All capital account transactions are prohibited unless they are specifically permitted. So you will get to know the difference between these two. Current account transactions are permitted unless prohibited. Capital account transactions are prohibited unless specifically permitted. So there has to be specific permission for a capital account transaction. And there is one interesting scheme which we also should know, is called as liberalized remittance scheme. So any Indian person, resident Indian, so person who was born in India, citizen of India, residing in India, can remit, like send the money abroad, up to an amount of $250,000 per financial year without any restriction. It can be capital, it can be current. Specific regulations will be followed, but there will not be any approvals which are required for any transactions up to $250,000. You can invest, you can make the payments to the things which are not specifically prohibited or regulated. So you can do anything up to 250,000. This is applicable only to resident Indian individuals, not to the companies. So these are very, very important provisions of current and capital account transactions. I will just run through. These slides are just for your information. I know that we are running out of time because we are already 40 minutes we have spent, and we have got more 15 minutes. So I would like to spend some time on FDI, foreign direct investment. And these are the restricted current account transactions. So lottery winnings, you cannot remit, you cannot receive remittance from racing, riding, and such. So illegal activities or certain things which are specifically restricted under current account transactions are mentioned here. I will definitely share the PowerPoint presentation with all the students so that they can go through it and they will get benefited. Then few capital account transactions are completely prohibited, like chit funds, nidhi companies, agriculture, real estate, trading in transferable development rights. So TDR trading, everything, they are completely restricted. So a foreign company, if you might be listening to the three bills which are being discussed in agriculture related, farming and agriculture related this thing. But in that also, the foreign investor cannot do a business of agriculture in India. Agriculture, horticulture, real estate. Because what will happen if a foreign company starts acquiring real estate near the border areas, slowly they can encroach into the Indian territory. So that is why such transactions of capital nature, because purchasing of immovable property will come into capital account, because we have seen that whatever affects balance sheet is a capital account, whatever affects the P&L is a current account. So such transactions are specifically restricted under capital account transaction also. Rest all are as per foreign direct investment or external commercial borrowing regulations. So we will see what are the foreign direct investment cases. So you all must be aware that foreign companies come to India. We have heard about 1600, wherein British East India Company came to India for doing business. And what they did a real business and took out most of the funds of India abroad, and including the Kohinoor and so many things we have learned in history, and so many other places we have learned that. So foreign investment is a very, very important concept if we consider India, because India is very good in resource. It might be human resource. You all must be aware that most of the big foreign companies or countries having their CEOs, CFOs, who are Indians, including Google and so many other big companies. You all must be aware about this. So human resource is one of the most important resource in India, and people come to India for that particular purpose, as well as it's a market. It's one of the biggest market after China. So when it comes to consumer goods, India is the biggest market. That is why people come to India. And foreign, and now what happens is rupee is cheap than the dollar. So conversion rate also, they get benefited. So, and now India has opened up. India has allowed foreign companies to come in India. You might have seen that when this India-China thing happened in March 2020, UP government announced that we are open for FDI and foreign direct. If some foreigner wants to invest in India, we will provide them a lot of ease of doing business. We'll provide them ease of doing business, and we will allow them to work in India, establish their factories in India. We will provide benefits in respect of electricity, labor laws concession, and so many concessions. So we want investments in India so that our foreign exchange reserve goes up. So that is how foreign direct investment comes into picture. So investment can be made in companies, partnership firms, LLPs, and proprietaries also. So for every such investment, there is a requirement of reporting to Reserve Bank of India. We don't need to go for a prior approval, except in certain cases wherein it is about sectoral limits or prohibited sector. So prohibited sectors are like atomic energy, which is very crucial for India. Railways. So in railways, no one can invest. No foreign company can invest in India for railways. Aviation, in certain cases, up to 24% it is allowed. in insurance, up to 49% of capital you can take it from foreign companies. But if you talk about IT or manufacturing companies, then 100% investment of foreign companies are allowed. Like Volkswagen India, they have invested around 1,600 crores in India just for setting up their plant and running their plant. So that is how foreign companies come to India and invest, and that is how they are working. So whenever there is a allotment of shares, the company issues the shares, there is a requirement of FCGPR. This is a form which is required to be filed with Reserve Bank of India through your authorized dealers. It requires a valuation of shares. So you have to value your shares, and you cannot issue below the valuation which has been given. You have to receive the funds from a normal banking channel, and you will have to submit these returns within 30 days from the date of allotment. Then only your entire transaction will be legal. If you miss any of this transaction, then you will be liable for penalty. And maximum penalty, as we discussed in the first slide also, is the 300 times of the amount involved. So if you bring in 1,000 rupees, you will be required to pay, you may be required to pay, depending on the intensity of the non-compliance, amount up to 3,000 rupees, which is huge. So we'll have to be very careful when we talk about the FDI compliances. There is a requirement of a certificate from a company secretary. So compliance certificate has to be issued by him, and it has to be submitted to Reserve Bank of India. Transfer of shares from one person to another, there is a requirement of filing form FCTRS. So it is nothing but foreign currency transfer. One is foreign currency allotment. So these two forms are similar in nature, and that has to be filed through authorized dealer on an online mode. There is no physical form filing required. So everything goes on an online mode. So you'll have to be very careful when we talk about this. Yeah, one more important point is, there are different kinds of capital. One is equity capital, one is preference capital, one is debenture, and then there are hybrid documents like convertible debentures, convertible preference shares, and so on and so forth. So now, whenever you are talking about compulsorily convertible shares, it will be treated as foreign direct investment. But when you talk about optionally convertible or non-convertible, redeemable shares, preference shares, or debentures, it is treated as external commercial borrowing for the purpose of Foreign Exchange Management Act. So we will come back to external commercial borrowing. So what happens? I will give you one example. A foreign company, which is a holding company abroad, and there is an Indian company, which is 100% owned by that foreign company. Now I want to fund my Indian company. What I will do? The holding company will transfer crores of rupees as trade advance. They will say, okay, we are giving you trade advance. You do your business out of the trade advance. And whenever you make profits, you pay back the trade advance to us or give the final product which you are manufacturing to us. It is possible. So there will be no restriction. There will be no protection against the increase of exchange rate. So if the exchange rate goes up, exchange rate goes down, there will be either foreign exchange loss, foreign exchange gain, and the reserves of India will get adversely affected. So what Reserve Bank of India says, that whenever there are such trade advance, it has to be repaid within 1 year. That is the maximum limit up to which you can give the trade credits to each other. So foreign company can give loan, foreign company can give trade advance up to 1 year. Indian company can give trade advance up to 6 months. Again, saving of our foreign exchange. And there is one concept called as external commercial borrowing. As I told you, in Japan, there was a cost which was required to be paid if you put a FD in a bank account. So I've got a lot of money. I have to keep my FD with the bank. Then bank will charge you interest. This was a situation in one of the bank in Japan. Because of their reserves, foreign exchange reserves, or requirement of funds in the market. Yeah, so it was other way around. Now what is happening here in India, as I told you earlier also, the rate of interest is around 8%, and from abroad you can get a loan at around 2%, 3%, or even lesser than that. So why people are not going to ECB route more often than never? They are not going for ECB because there are restrictions. Only certain classes of lenders can give you money. So your shareholders can give you money. Third party cannot give you money. Your shareholders should hold minimum 25% in your capital. Then only he will be allowed to give you money. Only companies can take the money. Individuals cannot take the money. LLPs cannot take the money from abroad. You cannot take loan from abroad. Even the individuals cannot take it, take a loan from their relatives abroad. So for transfer of any money from abroad to India, India, resident Indians, if we talk about, and they want to show some transaction or do some transaction, it has to be done through a gift mode, not through a borrowing mode. So we will have to be very careful. Then there is a restriction on all-in cost. The restriction is around 4.5% plus 6 monthly LIBOR. LIBOR is a concept. This is a prime lending rate of European currency, euros. So it cannot go beyond 4.5 plus LIBOR, 6 month average LIBOR. LIBOR is around 1.8 to 2.2. So plus 4.5. So around 6-7% is the all-in cost on which you can take the ECB, external commercial borrowing. And after taking this loan, the debt equity ratio, you all must be aware about debt equity ratio because you are management students. Yeah, the ratio of your equity with debt should not exceed 1:7. So you are having 1 rupee as your equity, that is share capital. The loan cannot exceed 7 rupees. So debt equity ratio should be maintained at 1:7. So this is very, very important. So once you enter into a transaction of external commercial borrowing, you will have to file one form which is called as ECB. And once you file this particular form, you will get a loan registration number. Once you get this loan registration number, you are allowed to freely get the money from abroad up to the limit mentioned in ECB, might be 5,000 crores or whatever crores. Yeah, you can take that money in your account, spend that money, and every month inform Reserve Bank of India, inform ECB too, about your utilization. There are restrictions on how you utilize and for how much time you can keep. So there is average maturity period. So usually it is from 3 years to 7 years. So for 7 years, you should keep the money in India. Then only external commercial borrowing is allowed. So this is how the external commercial borrowing and trade credits works under FEMA. So these are the normal things which you must know as a person who would be advising the management or would be part of management or taking certain decisions for you or your company individually or for the company as a corporate. So you can take all these things with you. You must keep these points in mind whenever you are dealing with a foreign exchange. And next one slide, in next 3 minutes, I would like to conclude my presentation. That next one slide is about various offenses which happen, or I would say various transactions which are treated as offense under Companies Act. And if you do any of these transactions, even by mistake, you will be responsible for the penalty. And the penalty amount, as I mentioned, it will be around 3 times of the amount involved. So we'll have to be very, very careful. And it also has some imprisonment provisions because it would be treated as criminal in nature. So these are the 4 important points when we talk about the offenses. So first offense is hawala. You all must be aware there is a concept called as Angedia in India. So one person sitting in Pune, one person sitting in Chandigarh, yeah, they are sitting there and they are well known to each other, Mr. A and Mr. B. They know each other very well. So now one person from Pune want to transfer 5 lakh rupees from Pune to Chandigarh. How he will do it? He will have to do through online mode. Yeah, he will have to draw a check, RTGS, NEFT, Google Pay or UPI or certain other possible means. But if you don't want to get into that, if you are into parallel economy, what you will do, you will pay 5 lakh rupees to Mr. A. Mr. A will inform Mr. B, who is sitting in Chandigarh, saying that, okay, I have received 5 lakh rupees, now you pay it to Mr. X. On the basis of instruction of Mr. A, Mr. B pays 5 lakh rupees to Mr. X without actually transferring the money. Second transaction will be from Chandigarh to Pune, 3 lakh rupees. So now only 2 lakh rupees will be sent by A to B, but there is a transaction of total 8 lakh rupees. So understand this. This is called as hawala. And when it comes to cross border, then this is more and more dangerous. And then FEMA comes into picture and RBI regulates all such transactions. We have seen that even WhatsApp messages are getting tracked. Even you all must be aware that a few years back in 2016, KKR, the Kolkata Knight Riders, were summoned by Executive Enforcement Directorate for issuing the shares below the valuation under FDI. So such offenses get tracked from RBI and they will summon you for any of the non-compliances. So this is kind of hawala. Money laundering is actually laundry. Laundry is what laundry does? It cleans up. So any money which has been received from a parallel economy is placed into different segments. Different segments makes different layers. So if I have received 50,000 rupees in cash, what I will do, I will put 1,000 rupees in my infrastructure project, 1,000 rupees I will put in IT project, 1,000 rupees. So there is a limit on cash transaction, 20,000 rupees per day. So and accordingly, I will put in all these different businesses. All these businesses will be billed by a third party. Yeah. And they will raise a bill on all these companies. And then these companies will pay in check. So that third party providing services will consolidate. So what happened? The black money which was put in all these different layers became fresh and became clean and became white in the hands of receiver. So this is called as money laundering. Money laundering gets trapped and tracked, and RBI is very strict on this, and they will punish you with lot of offenses and a lot of imprisonments. Round tripping is something like I pay you, you pay me, and you keep on doing this. So there is no actual increase in transaction. So I purchase mobile from you today at 10 rupees. Tomorrow I pay you 11 rupees and get another mobile. And same mobile, you are doing it as a round tripping. So if I invest in Mauritius. In Mauritius, there is no restriction. That Mauritius company invests in India and we do the transaction of sale and purchase between these two companies. So actually I am doing transaction with myself. So this is called as round tripping. This also gets covered. And the last and most important is, now Reserve Bank of India is looking at ultimate beneficial owner. So who is the man behind all the companies? So when we talk about Reliance, we talk about Ambanis. Same way they are trying to find out who is behind the company. So an Indian company which is having its bosses in China, they will be treated as ultimate beneficial ownership, and those people will also be restricted from entering into Indian market as on date. So these are the things which I wanted to share with you. Thank you very much for your patient listening, and you can contact me anytime if you feel like. And I'm really happy and thankful to the organizers for inviting me at this particular session. If you have any questions also, you can write to me on WhatsApp or even on email. I usually respond to all the queries of all the students and all the participants of my session. So thanks a lot. Again, I would like to thank Dr. Katoch for inviting me here. And I hope that I have I've said whatever I could and shared whatever little knowledge I have with the students, and it will be helpful for them. Thank you very much.
Yes, ladies and gentlemen, with this, we are coming to end our lecture on Foreign Exchange Management Act. And this lecture, I suppose, is wonderfully delivered by C.S. Devendra Deshpande, who very graciously responded to our request and agreed to be here on the platform and share his rich experience and knowledge on Foreign Exchange Management Act with MBA students at Lovely Professional University. And sir has tried to cover all the dimensions of Foreign Exchange Management Act in this very short span of time. He covered foreign direct investments, he covered ODIs, he covered compounding, he covered even the contraventions under Foreign Exchange Management Act. And thanks to the listeners and the viewers and all the stakeholders for patiently hearing. And also we have got so many queries, sir. Definitely we will send all these queries. We will WhatsApp you or we will mail you, because students are so curious to know about this. And for your kind information, sir, this law is an integral part of MBA program at Mithun School of Business, Lovely Professional University. Because we believe all managers and entrepreneurs, they should have the knowledge of legal aspects of running business in India. And thank you so much. Absolutely. And we believe that you join us in our future endeavors as well. And listeners, viewers and listeners, stay connected with us in our upcoming endeavors on Consumer Protection Act, Companies Act, Insolvency Bank, Bankruptcy Code, and also Trademarks and Patents Act. Thank you so much, sir. Thank you. All the best.
Thank you very much. Thanks a lot. Namaste.